So, Serena, I got one.
What?
So...
No, I need one.
Something happened, okay?
What?
We talked about how in the 1800s, there was a lot of cult things that were going on, how the church really wasn't being that effective. You know, we talked about a lot of those different things, right? But something very important happened that I have left out between the 1800s and the early 1900s. This thing completely changed how the church operated. It changed how missions was being dealt with. It changed the direction that religion in America was going. Does anybody know what this event was?
This was in the 1800s?
The early 1900s.
Oh, Azusa Street?
Can you repeat what you said?
Yes. In the 1800s, all the cults started coming up, and the church was mostly, you know, not mostly, but a large part of it was, you know, nothing very effective, that kind of stuff. But something happened at the beginning of the 1900s, okay, that changed what the church was looking like. It changed missions, and it completely, I want to say, revived. What happened?
All I can think of is Azusa Street.
Before that, which led to that.
Before 1906, then. Mm-hmm. Oh.
Revival started out in Topeka, Kansas. Okay? This was very important, because it started breaking through different, I want to say, ethnic barriers that had been there. Started breaking through different economic barriers that were there. And it really got things going. This was in Topeka, Kansas, okay?
Is it something about the haystack meeting? Oh, what was it called? Do you know what I'm talking about, or no?
No, I have no idea.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
There is a thing, by the way.
But anyway, shortly after this, there was something called the Azusa Street Revival, and this is where the Assemblies of God actually gets their roots from. Okay, this forever changed what missions looked like. It forever changed the direction that the American church was headed in. Okay, even today, churches that aren't even Pentecostal have been affected by this change.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, it has completely changed everything that witnessing was about, evangelism was about. And what made this so important was the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. So we've been talking about all these different things with witnessing, all these different things with this and this and this. What was the game changer from the 1800s to the 1900s? The Holy Spirit. That was the game changer. Okay. Even nowadays, I mean, denominations such as Baptists are changing and stuff, where you have things like Reformed churches, which is basically the new Baptist church. Basically. Things were forever, the American church has been changed by that, which in turn has enabled us to go and change other places. Like, I know you guys have, over the past year, heard a lot of missionaries come to the church from South America, where the scene in South America is changing, as it is in Africa. And what's making the difference? The Holy Spirit is now being involved in the witnessing efforts.
Yeah.
Our missionaries are focusing more on spirit empowerment, focusing more on applying it to those contexts, rather than just trying to go and do good social works and whatnot. See what I mean? So that's really we're gonna hit on that a bit at the end of this lesson. We're gonna talk a little bit more about witnessing, but I just wanted to lay that out there. I still haven't fixed my thing. I don't even know where my batteries are, to be honest. So before we get going on the holidays. One holiday that I did not include on here, excuse me, is Thanksgiving. I don't know if you guys know where Thanksgiving came from, but when the Pilgrims came over in the early 1600s, Thanksgiving was their yearly festival that they did around harvest time. Okay, so just if you were wondering, that's where it originates from. So now about Christmas. I know there's been a lot of irritation from people about Christmas, so let's just kind of clarify a few things. Where we get Christmas is from a very old word in Christus Messa, which basically means Christ's Mass. You know, if you're familiar with the Catholic tradition, Mass, Christ's Mass, okay? Christus Mass, which comes from a word Christos, which is the Greek word basically meaning Messiah, okay? It means anointed one, okay? Now, if you notice, Christos, which is actually a Greek he, looks a lot like the English X.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout the years, people have then shortened Christmas with Xmas.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's where that came from. Mm-hmm. So when people say Xmas, they aren't actually taking Christ out of Christmas. They're just shortening it. It's not that big of a deal.
They're
Greekifying
it.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Once again, not something to, you know, lose
they
tempers about.
Don't
even know it. It's important to note that Christmas wasn't the original celebration on this day. I know people oftentimes don't know that. Throughout history, there were many different celebrations done around this time and on December 25th especially. One, if you look further down, is called Sol Invictus, which was actually a Roman pagan celebration thing. And the only reason why they had Christmas on the day of Sol Invictus was because they were trying to overshadow it. Take the attention off of it, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, historically speaking, Christmas wasn't... Oh, see what I mean? That's not that big of a deal. So, but Rome wasn't the only people to do something on this day. I believe it's called winter solstice. There's a lot of different things historically throughout the different cultures done on winter solstice. So there's something else too. Also, Christ's birth was not celebrated from the earliest times of the church. Interesting. It was first celebrated in the eastern side of the church. Yeah, eastern side of the church, I'm getting my bearings off, where it was actually celebrated on January 5th, which is, you know, as Epiphany, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And the 12 days of Christmas are actually the 12 days that relate between January 5th and December 25th, just in case you were wondering where the 12 days of Christmas fit in. If you want more information on that, I'm posting up some blogs on my personal blog this next couple weeks that'll talk about the 12 days of Christmas and the origins of Christmas in a deeper pattern than this, because it's just going to be real simple. But then when the western half of the church started celebrating Christmas, which wasn't until the 320s sometime, 320, I want to say 6, somewhere around there, they celebrated on December 25th instead because of Sol Invictus. There may have been some people who actually thought that Jesus was born on this date, but nowadays there aren't very many people out there who actually believe Jesus was born on December 25th. Newsflash, he wasn't. I don't really remember the exact date, but somewhere around April, if I remember correctly. So not really that big of a deal, but just pointing towards that. But the thing I want to point out is that Christ's birth was not celebrated from the earliest times of the church. The most important aspect of the life of Christ in the early church was his resurrection, his death and his resurrection. That was the most important thing. And the reason why is because, in fact, even if you look at the Gospels, how many Gospels have a record of Jesus' birth? Two. There's four Gospels. Only half of them say anything about his birth. All four of them say something about his death and resurrection, though, don't they? What was the main focus? Death and resurrection. Then if you read the Church Fathers, you know, Origen, all of them, the thing that they always talk about is Christ's death and resurrection. That was the most important thing. So when it's kind of important that we don't blow Christmas out of proportion, okay? I know a lot of times, especially in the modern church, people get really bent out of shape about Christmas. First off, remember, it wasn't always about Christmas, okay? There are other things that were celebrated on that same day, so don't forget that, okay? And then, once again, I think you get it. Christ's birth wasn't the most important thing. And remember, that's still true for today. Christ's birth is good and all. And it's important that we teach things like the virgin birth and that kind of stuff. But that's not the key of why Jesus came. The key of why Jesus came was to set people free from bondage. That's why he came, okay? So once again, the birth, important, not very important, though the death and resurrection, that's the thing that is most foundational to all the rest of the New Testament. So, and sadly, though, throughout time, it became a time of senseless partying within the church. A lot of drunkenness and that, like, similar stuff. So it actually evolved into something that was very similar to the pagan celebrations within the Roman Catholic Church. Sad, but, you know, I guess that's just the way of some things. They either die young or live to be the enemy. any questions about Christmas? Okay. That takes us to the second one, which is Easter. Now, Easter is actually a pagan holiday. It comes from Istra, the goddess of spring. In fact, the whole egg thing is associated with the pagan and with the cultic practice. And people don't know that, they just think, you know, hey, whatever. But that's actually where it came from. Nowadays, I wouldn't so much worry about it because it's more of just a game that kids play. I wouldn't really worry about it too much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But If it harms your conscience, by all means, don't do it. But I wouldn't condone you, you know, going and telling other people how it hurts your feelings. Because sometimes Christians do that. I don't think that's right because I don't think that it's right. Well, okay, so you don't do that, and I'll try not to do it around you, but that doesn't mean that I should, see what I mean?
Yeah.
So balance here. Mm-hmm. You shouldn't do things that offend people, but you shouldn't be offended by everything. And even if you are offended by everything, your weak conscience shouldn't justify someone else not even being able to go outside because of you. See what I mean? Balance. This is potentially the earliest celebrated Christian festival. It was the new church's version of the Passover, and the Jesus boop right onto the same day as Easter. And so what the Christian church celebrated was, now it's called Resurrection Sunday, but I believe that from the earliest times they just called it Passover. Mm-hmm. In the Christian church I'm talking about. let me think, what else was I going to say about that? Resurrection Sunday, I mentioned that. As far as whether you call it Easter or Resurrection Sunday, I wouldn't get too bent out of shape about it out of the way, because I don't think Easter is still worshipped. So, not really worth getting bent out of shape about, but just in case you're wondering about the origin. Plus, it's common culture to call it Easter, so it's not that big of a deal. I wouldn't be contentious one way or another. So, I think the important thing is who you're worshiping on that day. Yes. So, just on that there. About Lent, though, this is actually kind of interesting. The Christian practice of Lent was actually taken straight from the pagan practice. Mm. Yeah, Lent is actually a pagan practice that, for whatever reason, is now part of the Roman Catholic tradition. I thought that was kind of funny. But anyways, if you do Lent, because once again, who are you doing it for? You're doing it for God, so whatever. Any questions about Easter?
They did the same thing as Christmas did, put it on that holiday.
As I understand it, yes. As I understand it, yes.
No. Wasn't that goddess, wasn't it a rabbit?
What?
Is that where the rabbit comes from?
No, the rabbit, is a very productive creature and mates a lot. Okay. So it was associated with fertility. but the goddess itself was not a rabbit. So, good question though. Any other questions?
What's the eggs mean?
It's just a sign for the fertility thing. That's it. Because once again, the goddess of spring, kind of like for a year of more productivity.
Oh, okay.
But you know, like how some people would pray to certain gods for an easy labor,
right,
or to live through the labor.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. The third one's called Halloween, which this one's funny because it's actually known in popular culture by its Christian name, Halloween. That's its Christian name. So I thought that was kind of interesting. It comes from word basically All Hallows Day. This is the eve of All Hallows Day. Okay. All Hallows Eve is on the 31st of October. All Hallows Day is the September the 1st. Did I say that right?
November.
I'm sorry, yes. November the 1st. I'm going the wrong way, drastically. November the 1st is All Hallows Day. And this was actually a day for the remembrance of the saints that have died before us.
Oh, wow.
So that's what, you know. Once again, like many of the celebrations, this was a common time of celebration. Okay, so it's not necessarily connected with certain pagan practices. I know a lot of people say, in Ireland this happened. Well, yes, Ireland did have some pagan practices that happened about the same time. But once again, this is a very common time for the different worships. It's the harvest season. It's the end of the time change is going back and everything. Throughout human history, it's been a time of different things happening. But that doesn't necessarily mean that those things are connected with Halloween, and you just assume that they are is just wrong-headed. You shouldn't make historical claims unless you have data to back it up. But as I mentioned, there was pagan stuff going on in Ireland on the same day that predated Halloween. But then the idea of witches and trick or treat and all that stuff were actually little pagan things that happened that were added throughout time of the celebration. And this part is interesting. Some of these things were actually added in the early 1900s because or 1800s. I want to say 1900s, though, because people thought that it was a pagan holiday. So they just started adding things that they thought went with pagan stuff, like witches and stuff. So what you know of as Halloween today, so small resembles what was actually done, both on the pagan and the Christian front, that it just evolved into a whole new day. It's very interesting. And I don't even think All Hallows Day is even celebrated. I don't know. I haven't heard any news about it. But whatever. Kind of eclipsed by Halloween anyways. So Halloween itself obviously is not evil. Other things celebrated on it, they may not be good, obviously. But that's the same for any other thing, too. You could celebrate something on Christmas that could not be good. See what I mean?
Yeah.
Like worshiping a Christmas tree.
Yeah.
Or worshiping the manger. How many times have people made a big deal about the manger? When there's one verse of one gospel that even mentions the manger, I mean, okay. Once again, getting bent out of shape about the things that are very small issues. The purpose of the church is to seek and to save that which is lost. So, once again, when we get too caught up in tradition, we kind of lose sight of that focus. Any questions on Halloween? You look like something's forming in your head, no?
Okay. A sneeze.
Oh, okay. I think that's it for Halloween that I wanted to mention. So let's talk about a few other ones. Some of these aren't really related with Christian things, so I'll just bear with me here. St. Patrick's Day is actually a day for remembrance of a very good man who's known as Patrick. They called him Saint afterwards. Obviously, you have to be dead to be called Saint. Pastor's already talked about that, though. After much hardships, he went and started a very effective mission in Ireland. And whereas the majority of the Roman Catholic Church was doing this, you have to be like us, and then you can be saved and welcomed in. Whereas Patrick went over there and just said, basically, you know, let's see how you guys are doing things, and then welcomed them into fellowship, and then presented the gospel. Very effective, and he was able to contextualize the gospel for their people group. Obviously, mm-hmm. We as Protestants don't agree with a good deal of things that Patrick, you know, believed. But still, I mean, his efforts are still nevertheless very, I mean, amazing. Do what?
Commendable.
Yeah, commendable, yes. And so he really was really able to get, in fact, I believe he was the first person to actually get the church going in Ireland. This was, I believe, in the 400s, I want to say. Could have been later, actually. Don't hold me to that. I'm getting some of my dates confused. Regardless, sometime afterwards, the Roman Catholic Church got their fingers more into it, and it kind of just messed up with the church had going in Ireland. So, but anyways, I mean, it happens, I guess. And that's not the only place that, you know, tradition stunted the church's growth. Any questions about St. Patrick's Day? Okay. That takes us to these two ones, which aren't connected with Christianity. I just wanted to mention them because people get a little bit confused. Memorial Day is for the dead.
Yes.
Okay, the dead people who served. Veterans Day is for everyone who served, okay? All right, do you understand the difference there? Because I remember Ben and I were doing announcements, and for Memorial Day, somebody was saying something for veterans, and we were just like, you guys aren't dead. None of you guys are dead. Sit back down. It was very awkward for me. I don't know if Ben was sharing that, but I was just dying. I was like, oh, God, please tell me I'm not as red as I feel. But anyways, two different things there. Not really related with the church, you know, just something I thought was interesting. Valentine's Day is kind of an interesting thing, how, you know, all this love and romance and everything, that was actually something associated with a pagan day called Lupercalia. The story of St. Valentine is very mixed. I mean, there's like 20 different accounts of what actually happened. I just left off any account of what happened because it's like, I'm not going to give you guys, maybe it was this, but maybe this happened, or maybe this happened. There was a guy named Valentine who evidently attained sainthood, you know, obviously, and this day was named for him. However, the whole romance thing was mostly associated with Lupercalia.
The main one I heard was that he used to go visit prisoners.
Yeah, that was, yeah.
And minister to prisoners in prison. Mm. And he would write them notes. And
yeah, that, I heard that one too, yeah. Well, let's stick with that one. Let's say that one.
Yeah.
Plus, I can't remember any of the other ones right now, so we'll see that one. Are there any other holidays that you guys were curious about? I tried to hit the ones that you guys actually probably know about. All right. So that finishes up on the holidays. That takes us to a little bit of a discussion now. There are some people who take this stance. It just doesn't matter where it came from. Which can be true, but can also not be true. Okay. For instance, the peace sign originated from when Christians were being hung or crucified upside down. Mm-hmm. However, in nowadays culture, people don't really know that. So is it right or is it wrong for that kind of stuff? Mm. See what I mean? And you get into this kind of weird place of ambiguity. Mm-hmm. And so I have developed some things that I think kind of bring clarity to it. First off, before I go to the things that I think bring clarity, make any day a day of worship. I think that should be on the first on the Christian agenda there. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter if there's a Christmas day or if there's an Easter day or whatever. It doesn't matter. Every day as a Christian is a day of worship. So don't get too bent out of shape about what happens on December 25th or how popular culture worships December 25th. Don't be too worried about the things that happen on February 14th. It just doesn't matter. What matters is how we respond to it. Does that make sense? Remember that culture was never expected to be Christian in this world. We were expected to be Christian in this world.
Right.
So you would see the difference? So it doesn't matter what our government does. It doesn't matter what people do. It matters what we do. Like the problem with the refugees. I don't think that America should, throw away defense and go out there and do all kinds of dumb and ignorant things. Of course, they should worry about the safety of Americans. That's their job as the government. That's the government's job. Governing things, mm-hmm. by all means. What I'm saying is that Christians should be the ones to serve the refugees, to provide for the refugees, that kind of stuff, to make a difference. That's what I'm saying. The Christians should be at the forefront of these kinds of things. Mm-hmm. I'm not commenting on what the government should do. And actually, a lot of times that I say we should do this, people think that I'm talking about the government. Don't become so nationalistic that you think everything Christian has to do directly with the government. So, once again. But anyways, also, show Christ year-round. I don't understand the stupidity of the statement. One month a year, we celebrate Christ's birth by buying a bunch of gifts. Yeah. And all my family has to join together for this. And this is supposed to be a time of peace, even though I start it by Black Friday, the biggest shopping day of the year.
It's the most chaotic time of the year.
That doesn't make sense to me. It doesn't make sense to me. See what I mean? First off, I don't understand why dedicate an entire month to Christ's birth when Easter gets a day.
Yeah.
I don't understand that at all.
Right.
I mean, I'm not condemning worshiping or practicing Christmas. I by all means, go for it. But what I'm saying is, I don't understand why has all the shifted gone to birth?
Yeah.
Why was that a thing? I don't understand that. But anyways, we should be people who show Christ year-round. People are so concerned about taking Christ out of Christmas. This is how you take Christ out of Christmas, by your attitude. Mm-hmm. That's what takes Christ out of Christmas. Obviously, focus on God's good deeds. I don't really want to elaborate too much on that. Never become embittered about what the world worships. This is just a good thing to remember. Don't become embittered about what the world worships. Can you believe that the government did this or that these people did this? It's the world. Like Chuck and I were talking about the whole homosexual marriage being legalized. It's the world. What did you expect from them? Mm-hmm. If they could have attained a salvation by themselves, why would Jesus have even come? So I mean, like, we're expecting our culture to be Christian when the truth is that the majority of our culture isn't even associated with the church.
Right.
Why should they be Christian when they aren't even part of the church? Why is that a thing? Anyways, just a few things. Don't be one of those contentious people. There's some people who take the holiday thing to one extreme. don't call it Halloween, don't worship Halloween, don't this Halloween, Then there's other people who go to the other extreme, and they worship, like, everything, you know what I mean? Oh, it's Easter, yay! Woo-ha! And they go way overboard, and they see December 25th and everything, it's the most holy day of the year. Why? Jesus wasn't even born on that day. Why is it the most holy day? Why? I don't get that. See what I mean? So don't go to either, and don't go to the extremes on this one, honestly. And just whatever take you settle on this, don't be contentious either way. You know what I mean? Like, I so many Christians I've seen getting so, such in a huff and a puff about the whole Christmas thing. December is the yearly time for pastors to hide as their lay people throw chairs about the deterioration of Christmas. anyways, also don't forget that originally it wasn't even Christmas. Originally it was Sol Invictus, and whatever was before that. So I mean, like, don't get too off thing there. I hear some people talking about boycotting some of them. If you're going to boycott one, you better boycott all of them. Mm-hmm. I don't celebrate Resurrection Sunday or Easter, whatever you want to call it, because it was on a pagan holiday. So was Christmas. So was Halloween. I mean, let's go down the list. You know what I mean? If you're going to boycott one, you might as well boycott all of them. Mm-hmm. Once again, what is Paul's take on this? He said some people hold one day as super, super special, and other people hold every day as special. Whatever your conscience allows for, do that. Mm-hmm. So I think that maybe we should do the same thing too. Yeah. If you want to hold every day as special, go for it. If you want to hold certain days as being over above another one, that's fine too. It doesn't matter if you go to church on Saturday or Sunday or Monday or Tuesday. It doesn't matter. Like Seventh-day Adventists made a big deal about this with it being the mark of the beast and all this nonsense. You don't have to go to the weird.
Yeah.
You don't have to go to the weird. You can keep it, like, you know, G-rated and everybody's happy. Already mentioned that. So then people say, well, it's become evil or good. Mm-hmm. Okay, like Easter has become a good day. Or Christmas may have started out on a day that was evil, but now it's good. Or whatever. For that, I want to reemphasize this. First off, don't harm your conscience. Okay? Whatever you do, don't do something that you believe to be a sin. James very specifically says that for someone who believes something is a sin and then does that, it's a sin for them. See what I mean? So if you are having a problem in your conscience doing something or not doing something, then by all means, do or don't do it accordingly. You shouldn't ever test your conscience like that. However, if you see someone else doing that thing that bothers your conscience, don't condemn them for it. Let's say, for instance, I call it Halloween and that offends you. Don't make a major out of a minor. That makes sense?
Mm-hmm.
Don't be first to judge others. Be the last person to judge others. Be the first one to give people the benefit of the doubt. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
For instance, there's people in our church, even today, where we can't put Halloween on the board for the Harvest Fest.
Yeah.
Even today, in our church today, not just our church specifically, but our American church today, that you can't put Halloween on the board. It will greatly offend people. In our community here, it probably actually caused the different churches around here to actually look down on us as well.
Yeah.
Besides offending some people in our church, even though Halloween comes from a Christian celebration, All Hallows Eve, it doesn't matter. See what I mean? It has become something in their mind where it condemns their conscience. So what should we do? Maybe not put it on the board just for their conscience sake, right?
Right. Right.
Why start a battle if you don't have to?
Right.
I mean, you guys who are parents or have been parents, why start a battle with your kid about something that's a minor deal? You know what I mean? Like, sometimes I'll go to spank Micah for something and I'll be like, "What? Not that big of a deal." You know what I mean? Just let it go. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Some things just aren't worth getting into it. And this is one of those things in a real world application, it's just not worth getting into. So which takes me to point three there. Don't purposely offend. If you know something offends your brother or sister, just don't do it.
Yeah.
Just don't do it. Not because you'll be condemned by God, but just to avoid the whole controversy in general. For instance, tattoos. I went to tattoo. People don't want me to get a tattoo because I'm a pastor in a church. Therefore, I'm waiting until those people die off, and then I will get a tattoo. No, I'm being serious. Because in a few years, people aren't going to care about tattoos.
No, right.
You just give it a few more years and they won't.
Weird. Yeah.
It was a culture thing for one generation.
Yeah.
And now that generation is mostly dying off. So just wait a few years and go crazy. See what I mean? It's not something that needs to be an issue. So can you take something bad and turn it into good? For the most part, yeah.
Yeah.
And I think there's some things that, you know, that we can definitely do it on. Like, for instance, the peace symbol, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing necessarily inherently wrong with that, right? I don't know. In my opinion, is that it's not. However, then there's some things that you really can't, and I'll get to that in a second. Some things should still be avoided because of origin. Like, for instance, yoga, the forms of yoga.
Yeah.
That should definitely be avoided still because it is demonic, and that demonic practice is still going on. See what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, did you see what I'm getting at here?
Mm-hmm.
So, however, I do want to make distinguish something here. There is a difference between origin and shared traits. I don't celebrate Easter because it comes from a pagan holiday. Yes, Easter does. However, I celebrate Resurrection Sunday, which is on Easter, which does not. All it does is shares a trait, being on the same day. Mm-hmm. See what I mean? Christmas. I celebrate Christmas. I don't celebrate Sol Invictus. See what I mean? It doesn't matter. Notice what I'm saying. Christmas and Resurrection Sunday did not have their origin in that thing. Okay, I'm not condoning for you to go out and worship Easter,
right.
Or Easter, I mean. I'm not condoning that, okay? All that I'm saying is that these things didn't come from that. They simply share the same day. You understand the difference there?
Yeah.
So, like, for instance, yoga doesn't share traits with demonic activity. It has its origin in demonic activity. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It actually came from those Hindu practices.
Uh-huh.
It came from that. The forms have specific meanings according to Vishnu and all these other ones. See what I mean?
Right.
They were written by that for that. Does that make sense? However, Resurrection Sunday, that's not the case. It was just on the same day. See what I mean? So I do want to establish that there is a difference between originating and sharing traits. Okay? And then the last thing of little side notes here. So different celebration on same day versus celebrating that day. I already mentioned that. Okay, that's all I wanted to mention. Okay, so any questions about holidays in general or any of the things we talked about? I'm going for it. Boop. Okay, so that takes us to the church of today. The church of yesterday, you know, 50 years ago and so, was a very contentious group of people. They were a people who honored pews over people, hymns over evangelism, form over prayer, wearing suits to church over being the church. So that takes us to the question, what do you hate about church? Think about it. Don't answer, but just think about this. What do you hate about church? We are the church of today.
Mm-hmm.
Those things that you hate in the church, change. Be the difference.
Mm-hmm.
See what I mean? Be the change. If you're going to believe in something, know why you believe it, gosh darn it. And believe it if it's worth believing in. And if it's not, then just drop it. See what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, where do I stand on should you or should you not celebrate Christmas? It doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
It's that simple. It just doesn't matter. See what I mean? It's the same thing for Halloween. It's the same thing for Easter. Go down the list, St. Patrick's Day, Valentine's Day. It doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
It just doesn't. So what change do you want to see? I want to see a church that loves people and stops arguing about things that don't even matter. So what am I doing? I'm trying my very hardest to love people and to stop arguing about things that don't matter.
Cool.
I'm trying to take a stance for the things that actually do matter.
Yeah.
We've been talking all this year about cults. All this year about believing in things that make you get away from salvation.
Yeah.
See what I mean? Those are important things. That's not things that my opinion is this, my opinion is that. I know in a relativistic society, they tell you that. It doesn't matter, all faiths lead to the same thing. But as a Christian, I don't want to see relativism take over the church. So I'm being the change. I'm encouraging Christians as best as I can, and I'm teaching them so that they're not ignorant of these things. I've emphasized a lot over the past year about science and philosophy. Why? Because I don't want you guys to be ignorant of how the world is. A lot of Christians think that to live by faith means to completely block yourself off from the physical world. I have to accept my faith. It's blind faith. Blind faith. It's only a blind faith if you make it a blind faith. You know what I mean? You don't have to live like that. Like, for instance, some people... I'll give you a perfect example. The church was formed in 4000... I mean, sorry. The world was formed in 4000 BC. Will you get that from where? Oh, the Bible says it. No, actually it doesn't. See what I mean? And so by not studying the literature, they have drawn a faulty conclusion by taking... the genealogies and doing a literal back to back and ignoring how the language works. That's not how Hebrew works. See, I mean, those genealogies were never meant to be taken literally. What do I mean by that? Those people didn't actually live. No, those people lived. However, just because it says son of does not mean direct descendant of. Like Micah is my son. In Hebrew, it doesn't work like that.
Right.
For instance, Randy, Micah is Randy's son. In Hebrew, that's how they would word that. They would skip and only hit the people who are important or that they want to emphasize. See what I mean? But for whatever reason, instead of studying, people just blindly, I can't know that there's knowledge out there. Well, that's not wise at all. Jesus said to be like that shrewd manager. You know what I mean? Not to block yourself off from the world and just come to your own conclusions and stick to it as blindly as you possibly can. That's not what the church is about. So, make the church what you want it to be. However, I do want to give a word of warning. There's something called ecumenical movement, or ecumenicism, okay? Basically, let me reword this for something a little bit smaller, because that word scares me. United church, okay? And people go to two extremes on this, okay? They think all churches can be united. That's taking it too far. They say that all Protestant churches can be united. Good.
Mm-hmm.
See what I mean? Okay.
Right.
See what I mean? You don't have to take this to the weird.
Yeah.
Do they believe in salvation through Jesus Christ and Him alone?
Mm-hmm.
Grace. No works. Yes? Then you can be united with them. Do they believe that God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Yes? Then you can stand in them. Those are really the two things that depend on all other doctrine. If you remember when Ben was talking about the Mormons, remember how he said a lot of this you just have to come back to who God is because it just branches from that. Remember how I said that?
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly what I'm emphasizing with this. A lot of it comes down to those two points of doctrine. Even how you understand communion is not essential.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you think of it as just a memorial or whether it's actually turning into the blood, a body and blood of Christ or whatever, doesn't really matter, does it? No, he just said do it. He didn't say do with perfect understanding. See what I mean? But we've made something big where it's not something big. That makes sense? So... there is a balance in that ecumenical movement. So as far as witnessing tactics, and we've talked about this before, be patient. In all your witnessing efforts, be patient. Okay, I've mentioned this 100 times. Rome was not built in a day. Okay? You need to be patient with your witnessing. I know some people get patient and you get impatient. Peter even mentions about, you know, the wife, and we've talked about this, right? I mean... I'll come back to that. Yeah, I don't want to talk about that right now. But about being patient for things rather than just demanding it now. You know what I mean? Well, I prayed for this person to be saved, and they're not saved. Okay, I didn't know God was on your clock. See what I mean? We have to be patient about these things. And see, and you know, I tell stories about this all the time. I've known people who sought after the Lord for something for their entire life. And 2 weeks before death, received it, only to die 2 weeks later.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? This physical world is not what life is all about. Our comfort in this physical life is not what God is all about. One person a couple years ago was newly saved, and they made this statement. They said, doesn't God want me to be happy?
Mm-hmm.
Well, He doesn't not want you to be happy. Okay, but that's not His number one concern. His number one self... what?
It's not all about your happiness.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's not about you.
Yeah.
It's funny how we expect the world to know that when the church hasn't even learned that.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Oh, well, the church has to do it this way, and if the pastor says something wrong, I'm going to get offended and tell him how offended I am, or I'm just going to stop going to church, or, you know, this or this or this or the other thing. So tell me, haven't you just made it all about you? See what I mean? It was never supposed to be like that. So anyways, and then also notice that service does more for witnessing than you can ever imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Serving people, just simply serving them. You know, oftentimes we think that, you know, we have to go door to door in this awkward witnessing tactic. Oh my gosh, where you meet them outside of Walmart, for instance, and bombard them with Bible tracts. Bible tracts had their day in there about 50 years ago. Sadly, the church started passing them out after the fad was already over. But anyways, there's just other ways to do it, and Bible tracts is not it. Let's be honest here. Going to door to door, that just irritates people. Especially in a small town like ours. You, which church are you so I can know not to go there?
Right.
Oh, that one? Okay, don't worry. You won't see me there. You know, it just irritates people. It doesn't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
But service. Food pantry. That's a service. Okay? Lauren and I are growing chickens for the purpose of community aid.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Do you understand what that means? That means dedicating a good part of your life to disgusting creatures. Okay? That is service. And I'm not saying that to brag. I'm not trying to brag. I'm just trying to make it funny. Service is about inconveniencing yourself. Okay, that's what service is. If you're not inconvenienced, it's probably not service. David one time did something very, very bad. And as a result, a plague came on the land. Okay? So he goes to offer the sacrifice to God as a sign of his repentance. And the guy says, you know what, I'll just give you the land. You go ahead and sacrifice on it. And he says, no, you don't understand. I need to pay you for this at full price because I can't possibly give God a sacrifice that didn't cost me anything.
Right.
See, David understood the idea of sacrifice.
Yeah.
He was inconvenienced by it.
Right. Yeah.
See what I mean? That is service. If you're not inconvenienced by it, you probably aren't doing service. You could potentially be doing service. Like, for instance, let's say you work from home at a call center. Like, you do a call center from home. Well, that's going to be pretty easy to not be inconvenienced. But you get what I'm saying. And then thirdly there, be Spirit-led. When you depend on the Holy Spirit, your witnessing will always go smoother. Just throwing that out there. I mean, so much smoother. The things that you say will definitely be Spirit-led. But once again, the Spirit calls to remembrance what is there. If you want Him to bring to your memory Scripture, you best be in the Word. If you want Him to bring to memory something that He's spoken to you, you best be in prayer. If you want opportunity, you best be in prayer. See what I mean? We need to be Spirit-led, but that doesn't mean, oh, I depend on the Holy Spirit, so I don't even need to read my Bible anymore. Okay. You don't have to go to the weird. And don't forget in all this discussion, Reagan's game changer. Remember last week we talked about that video of Mondale and Reagan? And he said, no, I don't think my age is going to be a factor. And furthermore, I will not exploit for political reasons my opponent's youth and inexperience. And at that moment, Mondale said, at that moment, you see a smile on my face in the video, but you also see a tear in my eye at that moment because I knew at that moment that Reagan had just won. And it's so true. He turned a question that was awkward and that had no easy answer, he turned it around. When you're witnessing, it doesn't always have to be defense, defense, defense. Ask the questions too.
Mm-hmm.
Ask the questions. You know? Get them thinking. And I'm not saying attack.
Right.
There's a difference in what I'm saying here.
Exactly.
Rather than attacking, ask a question based on a flaw in the worldview. You say you don't believe in God, so where did everything come from? It evolved from what? What was this first evolved being, and how did it get to be there without some divine intervention? Oh, well, then that would mean that God would have to be created. By definition, no. No, by definition, because by definition, God would have to be something that's outside of the physical world, right? Which means it's immaterial. Remember we talked about this?
Mm-hmm.
A scientific definition of what would have to constitute God?
Mm-hmm.
Guess what? That's exactly what the Bible says God is. All those things that science says that God would have to be, that's what the Bible shows Him as.
Mm-hmm.
Someone that nobody can see. That make sense?
Yeah.
So anyways, flip it around like that, and it causes them to have to think. I was arguing with somebody about abortion, and they said, I don't think that there's anything wrong with abortion. I said, it really doesn't matter what you think. Genetically, it is a human being, and so when you are ending that life, you are killing them. And I said, well, it's just like a what is it called? Something that feeds off you? A parasite. It's just like a parasite. And I said, no, it needs something else for sustenance. That doesn't make it a parasite, as it's actually growing and developing, whereas a parasite is at its full stage in the organism that is being a parasite onto, what scientific data can you give me that says that it's not a human being? Well, no, I believe that it's a human. I just don't think it's wrong. And I said, okay, if it's a human, then it's murder. It's a person, and they didn't have anything else to say. So Gracie and I were talking about something, and something was brought up about isn't the Bible don't people find meaning in the Bible just simply by their own interpretation, which means every interpretation is correct? And I said, okay, that's called relativism. What you're saying is basically that every claim is valid, which is itself a claim, which if your claim is true, disproves itself. Mm-hmm. See what I mean? I said, So what basis do you have for believing in relativism when everything in reality is based off of a standard, a speed limit, for instance?
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't have anything to say. So I said, what basis do you do that on? They didn't have anything to say. See what I mean? It turned it around. They had to think about it because they didn't have an answer.
Right.
I believed this bullcrap my entire life, and now you're bringing something up that is conflicting with my retarded point of view. See what I mean? And I do mean that in a dictionary definition of retarded, being not developed.
Yes.
Okay? I'm not using that in just a flippant way. I'm using it in a dictionary definition way. Okay? So anyways, everyone makes claims. I want you to think about that. Well, Christians are just so judgmental on this and that and the other thing. Everyone makes a claim, and when somebody makes a claim, they genuinely believe the thing that they're thinking, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can't possibly think something and not believe it, right? Can you do that? Like, I'm a person. I believe that, right? So that would mean that, hypothetically, there could be something that somebody says that is true, hypothetically speaking. Is it so far to imagine that one thing that somebody says that might be true is that Jesus is the only way to salvation? See, I mean, everyone is making a claim in their belief system. Everyone believes something. An agnostic believes that there's not sufficient evidence to say whether there is or is not a God, so give them evidence. An atheist believes that there is no God. Based on the evidence, they believe that there is no God.
Mm-hmm.
Challenge the view. See what I mean? Cause them to rethink the things. Some people, especially around here in the Roman Catholic tradition, sadly, believe that tradition saves them. Tradition works. I'm not talking about all Roman Catholics, so I'm not going to touch that one. I'm talking about certain people around this community who think that the works will save them. See what I'm saying? Everyone is making a claim with the things that they say, the things that they do. Challenge those claims. Start asking questions. Start changing things around. Start turning it around where it combats what the devil has set up.
Mm-hmm.
See what I mean? Because don't make no mistake, relativism is from the devil. No way could that possibly have originated from man. Man's just not that smart.
Yeah.
This was definitely from the devil. And some other things too. So remember that when people say, you know, isn't that kind of arrogant for you to claim that Jesus is the only way? Everyone is making a claim. You're making a claim that I'm arrogant for believing my claim. What's the basis for your claim?
Yeah.
See what I mean? Everyone is making a claim. Otherwise, they wouldn't make the claim because they wouldn't believe it. And that, by definition, would mean that they were insane. See what I mean? Like, philosophically speaking, that doesn't make any sense. So that takes us to this. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. The first one is kind of out. The second one is in. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. He's talking about what we do in the world and what we do in us. Does that make sense? Okay. So I think that kind of summates everything that we've talked about. Any questions about any of this? So about the party, it's in three weeks. It's in 3 weeks, I believe. It's last Tuesday of the month.
Mm-hmm.
The baking it contest, I already mentioned this, but I want to re-mention it. It has to be dessert. You have to use a substantial amount of whatever is in your package.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be submitted anonymously. After they are graded, we find out who did what. Okay? So, any questions about the baking? Okay. Second, the question game. There will be a series of questions, and it will work very similar to the final round of Family Feud. I will ask the question. I will count to 10. You have to just write down whatever answer. At 10, you have to go to the next question. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
At the end, we go around and get the questions, and then you guys vote at which one you thought was the best. When I say funny, it doesn't have to be like rolling on the floor laughing. I mean the one that you got a kick out of. Okay. It has to be one that you thought was funny, that you got a kick out of. Then we have the gift game. Once again, you cannot buy. I've been to some doozy white gift exchange because people thought that it was serious and white elephant gifts are supposed to be funny. Mm-hmm. They're supposed to be junk gifts, gag gifts.
Yeah.
If you buy something for a white elephant gift, you've done it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, yeah. You cannot buy this thing. Whatever it is, it has to be something from around your house or outside or something. Just something like that, okay? And the theme is something you would give a friend before abandoning them in the desert. So whatever it is, put it in and make it look all pretty in your wrapping or whatever, and bring that. And it has to be according to that theme. So, and then the last thing, pizza and wings. I am buying this. If you would like to help me buy any of this, that's fine. Please don't give too much. I don't want anybody to feel like they didn't contribute enough and other people can, you know what I mean? I don't want to make people feel odd about it. So, okay. All right, everybody got it? Okay. So that's it for this week. Next week we'll talk about the woes of knowledge.
Oh, woe is me. I'm so smart.
So we're done?